John chapter 16 ends the portion of the text that has focused around the Last Supper of Jesus and that final intimate time that Jesus had with his disciples before the beginning of his passion. We had back in chapter 13 the discussion around the meal itself, and then following that, a final words of comfort to the disciples that began in chapter 14 and continued in chapter 15. And now as we come to chapter 16, we have the end of that, at the conclusion of which Jesus will take a few disciples with him, if not all of them, on his way to where he will be arrested and his actual passion will begin. But in chapter 16, we have the final words of advice that he shares with his disciples before he goes out and allows himself to be killed. The text begins in verse 1 with John writing, "These things," Jesus speaking, "these things have I spoken unto you, that you should not be offended." Jesus has said many things to them, some of which has upset them and saddened them, particularly him promising that, assuring them that he's going to die and leave them for a time. But he's been telling them so much more than that for the specific purpose that they should not stumble. The word offended means to stumble, to slip, to fall. And so he says, "I've been saying all of this not to upset you, but to prepare you when you go out and you continue to do the work that I started, so that you won't stumble, that you won't fall." And then he gives them some more insight along those lines in verse 2. He says, "They," your enemies, the very ones who are going to kill me, "are going to come after you. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time will come that whoever kills you will think that he does God's service." That sounds like the Apostle Paul, or the would-be Apostle Paul. While he was still a persecuting man attacking the Lord's church, he certainly believed he was doing right by God. He believed he was defending what he thought was the true religion of God, the Judaic philosophy. And so Jesus is warning them that there's going to be people a lot like that who are going to be following that same example, who are going to be attacking you, thinking they're doing what God wants. But you need to, the implication is, endure, resist, because you know what is right, even though they're misguided and they only think they're doing right. Verse 3, "And these things they will do unto you because they have not the Father nor me." Now, obviously they think they have the Father. They believe they're doing God's will, but Jesus assures them they don't have God, they don't have me. You have both. So you press on, you continue doing what is right because you know you're doing right. Don't let those who are doing wrong in the name of God dissuade you from doing right. Verse 4. "But these things have I told you, that when the time comes, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you." I didn't tell you all this scary stuff at the beginning of our ministry together, because I didn't need to. I was with you. I was your shepherd, guarding you as a guarding you like sheep. But now the shepherd is going to leave and leave this earth behind here in just a little while, and you're going to be left on the earth. So now I need to prepare you to be little shepherds in your own way, as you serve as the apostles of the kingdom that I am enacting. And so that's what Jesus is getting at here. I'm telling you all these things, and so when the time comes, you'll remember that I warned you. You'll remember that I knew all this. So it's not a surprise that I was in control, that I prepared you for this, so that when it comes, you won't have to panic, you won't have to worry, you won't have to wonder, what do I do? You just remember that I prepared you, that I'm on your side, that I'll take care of you from above. Verse 5, "But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you ask, where goest thou?" Now this seems to be a mild rebuke by Jesus. I'm going away, and I've been talking to you about this for three chapters now from our perspective, and yet none of you have asked me, where are you going? Now, they did actually in chapter 14, but not really. If you recall in chapter 14, they said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" So that wasn't really a question about where he's going. It was more about them. They had a question about where he was going, but they weren't asking, "Where are you going?" Because they weren't concerned about him. They were concerned about themselves. They were being selfish. "We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way to get to you? It's about us." So Jesus now calls them out on that, and he says, "I'm going to him that sent me, but you don't ask, where are you going? None of you have inquired about me. You're only worried about yourselves." Verse 6, "But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart." They're sorry because they are losing him. That's selfishness. Now, it's understandable that they would be sorry, but they seem to have no real concern about the Lord himself, what he's going to endure. It's only, how does it affect me? Verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. It will work out better than ever if I go. You're sad that I'm leaving you. It's a little bit of a shame on you for only thinking about yourself. But in the end, it's going to work out. It's going to be for the best. Because when I leave, I will send in my place the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, we learn. In fact, we'll learn again here in this chapter. But the Holy Spirit is the Comforter that he's going to send to his apostles to directly inspire them so that they will have everything they need, fully equip them to go out and to preach at the beginning of the gospel kingdom. Verse 8, and when he, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. How will he reprove? The word reprove means to rebuke, to scold. How will he do that? With the inspiration he's going to give the apostles, with the spiritual words they're going to have that will reprove and rebuke and exhort through gospel preaching, 2 Timothy 4. So he will do this. He will reprove the world of righteousness and of judgment and of sin. But now he explains those things in the next verses. Verse 9. Of sin, because they believe not on me, which is a sin. Of 10, of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. In other words, he's going to reprove the world of sin, but he's also going to lead people to righteousness. Sin is what keeps us away from Christ. Righteousness is what's going to put us into Christ. Verse 11, of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. The prince of this world is the devil. And so the judgment here is the rebuke of the devil himself. I'm going away. I'm going to send the Comforter. He's going to reveal all the information you need about how to reprove sinners, bring people into righteousness, and defeat the devil. Verse 10 again. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. Look at the contrast. I'm going to heaven. The prince of the world is judged. I'm going up. Those who are down are going to be judged. And one day, those who are here are going to come up with me. Verse 12. I have yet many things to say, but you cannot bear them right now. Why not? Why can't they bear them right now? Because of their sorrow? Because of their selfish attitude? Maybe both? But the point is, Jesus says, I have a lot more that I wanted to say. He just said quite a lot to them. I wish I could say more, but you can't take it right now. Verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. I have a lot more to say to you. The technical details, the minutiae of governing the kingdom of Christ here on earth as the apostles. I have a lot more I want to say to you about that, Jesus says. But I can't right now because your hearts aren't ready for that. You're not ready to have a big, long discussion about that. So, when I leave, I'll send the Spirit, and he will guide you into all truth. He will reveal all that you need to know so that you can have all the information and you can be fully equipped to go preach the gospel. Verse 14, he shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. I'm sending him. I'm going to give him the words to give to you. Now, there is an internal hierarchy here, an internal arrangement among the Godhead, the Father, Son, the Spirit, the first, second, and third personifications. They have that amongst themselves. It's not my place to question it or to wonder about it or to debate it. It is what it is. God has established his own orderliness for the way he handles himself. Jesus is just giving you a little inside scoop on that. The Father sent me, I send the Spirit. I speak of the Father, the Spirit speaks of me. Well, who speaks of the Spirit? Well, John does. John wrote the book. John speaks of the Spirit, but that's not the point. There is an arrangement that God has among himself, the three personifications of himself, that's not for us to debate. The point is just what Jesus says. I'm sending the Spirit, and he will tell you all that you need to know to tell the world about me. Verse 15. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. The Godhead in one here. Three personifications, but there is obviously some kind of a hierarchy here. The Father gave me everything, and I'm giving it to you through the Spirit, who will tell it to you about me. And you will turn and tell the world itself. So this is just Jesus giving them comfort. And that's why the Spirit is called a comforter, because they're losing their master. But he's replacing himself with something just as good but different, a spiritual being that can't be taken by force by the world. Verse 16. A little while, and you shall not see me. And again, a little while, and you shall see me. because I go to the Father. Soon, I'm going to die. Soon after, I'm going to be resurrected. Later still, I'm going to ascend. He's giving them the outline of the rest of the book of John. He's giving them an outline of the next several days. I'm going to die, and you're going to be without me for 3 days. Then I'm going to rise, and you're going to have me again for a little while, but then I'm going to ascend, and you're not going to have me in person anymore. But I'm going to send you the Spirit, the Comforter, and he'll be as good as me, and then you'll be with me in spirit. And then we'll be together forever after that. Verse 17. Then said some of his disciples among themselves, "What is this that he says to us? A little while and you shall not see me, and a little while you shall see me, because I go to the Father." What does that mean? They didn't understand. They questioned, but notice they questioned among themselves, not daring to ask the Lord himself. Though he is their teacher, they would have every right to ask him, but they don't. They inquire among themselves. They whisper while he's speaking. What does he mean? He's going to go and then come back and then go. What does that mean? Surely they know by now he's going to rise. He's told them multiple times, "I'm going to go and be killed, but I'm going to rise again the third day." He said that many times in his ministry, and here he's on the eve of doing it, and they're still questioning it. It just shows you the lack of awareness that the disciples had, the willing blindness that they had. And that's not a criticism of their teacher. He was perfect. It just shows you, no matter how good a teacher you have, the student has to play a part in the learning process. So they're asking among themselves. Jesus, verse 19, knew that they were desirous to ask him, and he said to them, "Do you inquire among yourselves of what I said? A little while you shall not see me, and a little while you shall see me. Are you asking among yourselves what I mean? Verily, verily, verse 20, I say to you, that you shall weep and lament, and the world shall rejoice, and you shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned to joy." He doesn't flat out tell them, but he means, I'm going to be killed, and the sinful world who kills me will rejoice, and you'll be sad. But in the end, it'll be you who's rejoicing. It'll be you who's happy, because you will get to see me rise from the dead. Verse 21, a woman, when she is in travail, has sorrow, because her hour has come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembers no more the anguish, for joy that a man is born into the world. A woman who is pregnant with a child, and she goes into labor pain, very painful, I've heard. And so she suffers through the labor pain, but as soon as she gets to hold that newborn baby in her arms, the memory of the pain washes over her, washes away, I should say, completely leaves her. And she no longer thinks about it. Suddenly, all the suffering she endured for however long she was in labor, it's all past. It's all worth it because she gets to hold that little bundle of joy. Jesus says, you're going to have pain. It's going to be painful and hurtful and sorrowful. But when it's past, it'll all have been worth it because I'll be resurrected from the dead to live forevermore. 22. And now, therefore, you have sorrow, but I will see you again. And your heart shall rejoice, and your joy shall no man take from you. Remember, back at the beginning of this conversation in chapter 13, at the very end of the chapter, he says, I'm going to go away and die. And Peter, you're going to betray me, but I'm going to go and I'm going to be crucified. And he opens chapter 14 by saying, but don't worry. Don't let your heart be troubled. And then he goes on to tell them why through 14, 15, and 16. And so he's kind of wrapping that up here toward the end of this chapter. I'm going to go away. You're going to have sorrow, but I'll see you again. And your joy will be so great, no one can take it from you, because it's rooted in a spiritual thing. It's not a physical object they can have that can be stolen from them, and therefore you lose your joy. No, this is a spiritual thing. The Christ who gives them joy by resurrecting will rise beyond this earth and live in heaven so that man cannot take him away. So their joy cannot be taken away. That's the ultimate comfort of all. 23. And in that day you shall ask me nothing. Verily I say unto you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. You got to go back to verse 18 and 19 here. Jesus was saying, you're asking among yourselves. No one's asked me any questions. You're asking among yourselves, what do I mean by this and that? But the day will come, he says here, that you won't have to ask any more questions because all the information you need will be given to you. The Father will give it to you, and whatever you ask of the Father, he'll give you in my name. Whatever questions they have, whatever problems they need addressed, they'll ask the Father, and he, through Jesus, through the Comforter, we learned earlier in the chapter, will give it to them. The whole hierarchy of God, the whole process of the Godhead, will work on their behalf. You have a question, apostles? The Father will give it to the Son, who will give it to the Spirit, who will give it to you. That's the inner arrangement of the way the Godhead is designed. Not designed, but the way the Godhead is organized by his own doing. Verse 24. Hitherto have ye asked me nothing in my name. Ask, and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. To this point, they would never ask anything in Jesus' name, because he had not yet ascended. If they had something they wanted to desire of God, they would ask the Father. But the day will come when they will get to ask in the name of Christ, who will sit on the throne of God the Father. Verse 25. These things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs, but the time comes when I shall no more speak to you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. I have been speaking to you in this kind of cryptic, metaphorical kind of way. I've told you stories to kind of convey the ideas of the truth that I'm giving you. But the day will come when I'll speak plainly. And I will speak plainly, he means, when he sends the Holy Spirit to give them inspiration. When that comes, they will have all that they need, information-wise. And they won't have to wonder, what does he mean by this story? Because they'll have the information. And then they can be the ones to tell the stories to the churches and to explain the gospel to them in their own way. Verse 27. For the Father himself loved you, because he loved me. And you have believed that I came from God, because you love me, because you trust in me, because you accept who I am. You know who I am as the Messiah. He says the Father loves you. That doesn't mean God doesn't love everybody as a universal general thing. This is the kind of love that involves an action on one's behalf. God is going to work with you, apostles. He's going to send you the information you need. This is a specific kind of thing Jesus is talking about. But the point is Jesus saying, don't worry, you're going to get what you need because you trust in me. So you got to keep chapters 14, 15, and 16 in context. There's a lot of universal truth we can apply, but the actual core of the message is a conversation between Christ and his 12 apostles. And so keep that in mind. It makes this text a little more clear. He's saying, you won't have to ask me of anything. It'll be sent to you. You don't have to worry about anything. It'll be given to you. You don't have to doubt anything because the Father will take care of you because you trust me. That, I think, will tie into what he'll say in chapter 17 when he offers his great prayer, which we'll get to next time, about unity and trusting in Christ and receiving the blessings of that. But to finish this chapter, verse 28, I came forth from the Father, and I'm come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father. This is what he was talking about in the previous verse. You trust who I am. You believe who I am. Well, who is he? He is the one who came from the Father to the world and will now leave the world to go to the Father. You trust that I am the Messiah come to the earth to do God's will, and to return to God after having done it. And that's who he is, and that's what he did. His disciples said unto him, verse 29, Lord, now speak plainly unto us, and speak no more proverbs. The idea is, he had just told them, the day will come when I won't speak to you in proverbs anymore. And so what we're seeing here is the short-sightedness of the apostles, impatience of the apostles. We want it now, Lord. We don't want to wait. Give it to us now. Tell us everything we need to know right now. But he's already told them these things you're not ready to hear yet, so I'll send the Spirit to give them to you. But they don't see that. They're being selfish. They're being stubborn. They're being impatient. And so they say, give it to us now. Verse 30. They continue asking him, now we are sure that you know all things, and you need not that any man should ask you. By this, we believe that you came forth from God. We know that you know all things. We know that you don't need to ask people anything, and that no one should have to ask you to give them anything, because you can give them whatever you feel is necessary. Your will be done. So why don't you give us the information now, is what they're saying here. We believe now. Speak plainly to us now. 31. Jesus answered them, do you now believe? Because he's already told them he's going to die and rise again, and they were just questioning that in verse 18. What does he mean when he says he's here, but he'll be gone soon, and we'll see him again? What does that mean? Well, if they believed in the resurrection, they would know what that meant. So he's putting them on the spot. Do you really believe when you say that you believe? Verse 32. Behold, the hour comes, yea, now is come, and you shall be scattered, every man to his own, and you shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. It's kind of a sad statement. He says, do you really believe in me? Not just do you understand the facts are true, but have you committed yourself to what those facts imply? Have you dedicated your life to the following of what those facts teach? Do you really believe with an action behind that thought? Because the hour is coming and is almost here, he says, that you're going to be scattered. That they're going to come to arrest me, and you fearing for yourselves, you being selfish, will flee from my presence. And indeed, that's exactly what will happen. Matthew says that they all forsook him and fled in Matthew 26:52. So it's the same thing here. Jesus says, you're going to leave me alone. And yet he says, I'm not alone. All of you will forsake me, but I won't be alone. My Father will be with me. He's always been with me. He'll always be with me. Last verse of the chapter, 33. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And so you have back at the beginning of this whole context, back in chapter 14, he opened it by saying, let not your heart be troubled. I'm going to go away, I'm going to leave you, but you're sad, but don't be sad. Let not your heart be troubled. You trust in God, so trust in me. He ends it by saying, because you trust in me, let not your heart be troubled. I've spoken to these things to you so that you might have calmness, non-troubledness, be have peace. In the world, you'll have tribulation. In the world, you'll have distress. In the world, you'll have the opposite of peace. You'll have conflict. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And if you have me, you've overcome it as well. And that's how he ends this beautiful context of chapters 14 through 16. Next time, we'll open up chapter 17, and we will read the true Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is not, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is a model prayer. The disciples asked him, Lord, teach us how to pray. What things should we say when we pray? Give us some general an outline of a prayer. So he gave them a good outline of a prayer. These words in chapter 17, this is the actual thoughts and heart on the heart of God in Jesus Christ. And he's going to pour them out, and John's going to record them for us. So we'll pick up with chapter 17 next time and see what the Lord has to say in his great prayer before he is arrested, convicted, punished, and crucified. But we'll pick up with chapter 17 next time. Until then, thank you very much.